found the, or we concluded that we can't have a very low value of D for buck, nor we can have a very high value of D for boost and buck boost type of converters. So therefore, I can't have a too low a voltage in a buck converter, nor I can have a very high voltage in a boost or a buck boost converter. Maximum ratio could be of the order of 7 to 10, not more than that. Then that was the end of my lecture. I derived a transfer function by using a transformer. What was the transfer function that I derived? I connected a switch battery to a transformer in this function, in this manner. I did not allow both the coils to carry current simultaneously. Purposely we connected this diode. Okay. Now by doing that, what we achieved? Whatever the energy that I stored here, by when I close the switch, gets transferred to the secondary. Okay. So if I connect a capacitor here, it gets charged. So now transfer function in this case happens to be N2 by N1 V naught is equal to N2 by N1 into VDC, okay, multiplied by D into 1 minus D. So I have, in addition to the transfer function of buck boost converter, I have another term which is the turns ratio N2 by N1. So there is a power supply what is known as the flyback converter. This diode is also known as the freewheeling diode, is also known as the flywheel diode. It is very popular up to say 150 and 200 is the upper limit. Why? We will see. So this is also known as the isolated buck boost, because transfer function is same as the buck boost converter, but then there is an isolation between input and output. Okay. So isolated buck boost converter. I am not, we already discussed the principle of operation, it is same. Okay, connect the diode accordingly and polarities of V naught. This is positive dot, this is also positive. So this terminal, sorry, current enters the dot, current enters the dot. So this is positive. Ensure that only one coil is carrying current. If, of course, you can put a dot here, at that time current leaves the dot. So in this case also current should leave the dot. I will repeat, I have put a dot here and directly connected to the positive of the battery, and when I close the switch current enters the dot, no need. Okay. I can connect it in such a way that current can leave the dot as well. Now if the current leaves the dot here, current should leave the dot in the secondary as well. So you connect the diode and the battery accordingly. Okay. How to determine the voltage rating the diode and the switches is given here. Current enters the dot of the tellurium, I2 should leave the dot, is explained. It is fairly simple. Go back and read. If you have still doubts, you can send me an email, no issues. When switch is open, flux in the core must be continuous. So I2 flow in the secondary in such a way that direction of flux due to I1 is same as that of the primary. Okay. Now there was a question, how does the current waveform look like in the primary? There are two possible conduction, continuous conduction and discontinuous conduction. Now here conduction means flux in the core has not become zero prior to closing the switch for the second time. I will repeat, continuous conduction in buck boost or chuck converter is the inductor current. Here when I say continuous conduction, it implies that there is a flux in the core is finite prior to closing the switch, that is all. Flux is continuous. Okay. So the BH loop looks something like this. The flux becomes 0, this is the residual flux, whatever it starts. Okay. When I close the switch, current increases, therefore the flux, and when I open the switch, current in the coil in the secondary decreases, and therefore the flux in the core as well, and I close it again. Now if the flux, if there is a finite flux, so BH loop looks something like this. Which mode we operate, we will discuss. So if I operate in continuous conduction, in other words, there is finite flux, or in other words, when I just prior to closing the switch for the second time in the primary, there was some current flowing in the secondary. There was some current flowing in the secondary. Instant, the moment I close the switch, whatever the current that was flowing in the secondary get transferred to the primary. Now it is I1. I1 increases linearly. It reaches a peak IP. Now the moment I open the switch here, this IP gets transferred to the secondary. Now I need to take care of the turns ratio. IP is flowing in N1. What should be its equivalent when it is flowing in N2? Okay. So, and current decreases. Similarly, this is the value of current just prior to closing the switch. It is flowing in N2 turns. When I close the switch for the second time, it gets transferred to the primary and it starts flowing in I1. So this value you need to you can determine by knowing the turns ratio. And see here, current in the coil I1 increases, flux also increases. It starts with a finite value of flux because flux is continuous here. It was flux, current since the secondary was carrying some current, there was some flux here. It increases and therefore it decreases. Generally operated in discontinuous mode. In other words, secondary current has become zero, therefore the flux in the core, okay. There is some time neither the switch nor the diode are conducting, okay. After some time switch S is closed and current starts increasing from zero, and this is the BH loop. If it is continuous, if it looks something like this. Now why am I saying that generally it is operated in discontinuous mode? Reason may be bit, reason is quite obvious. If I operate in this mode, okay, and accidentally, say for example, load has changed, see that load has changed, output, therefore output voltage will fall, okay. The signal comes to the controller saying that output voltage is falling. So naturally the controller will try to increase the value of D, duty cycle, okay. And if there is no limit on D, and if D increases to high value, your core may get saturated. Core may get saturated. See, I will repeat. I'll just show you the. See, you want generally the output voltage has to be regulated. V naught ref. This is V naught actual. Okay. Now, load. There is a sudden increase in load. Therefore, nothing has happened to the primary. Primary does not know, the controller does not know the load has changed. Current capacitor starts supplying the power, capacitor voltage will try to fall, okay. So V naught starts decreasing, it's trying to fall. It was almost constant, now starts decreasing. So this is error increases. There is a regulator, okay. Assuming that there is no limiter, assuming that there is no limiter, D has to D will increase. Controller says increase D. By increasing D, I can supply more power. So increase D. Now this increase in D might result in core saturation. So might increase in D implies that switch is open, switch is closed for a longer time. So flux continues to increase. It, okay. I have shown you linear increase because core is not saturated. Now for a higher value, since the D has increased, it may so happen that core may get saturated, and if that happens, you can see maybe smoke coming out of the flyback converter, okay. Because if the transformer core is saturated, current will be limited by the internal resistance of the coil. Fortunately here solar panel, there is a inherent short circuit limit. So you may have to take care so that nothing should happen through the devices, transformer, as well as other components. If you operate the core in saturation, so generally thumb rule is we operate in discontinuous core may saturate. Okay, this is how we have derived the transfer function. Increase in flux should be equal to decrease in flux. That's for steady state condition. Okay, same transfer function we have derived it. Okay. So therefore, magnitude of VDC can be significantly different. D max is generally kept at 0.5 and choose N2 by N1 suitably. Now, which is a very important parameter? It's L1 is a very important parameter that should answer why this circuit topology is popular for low power, why it is not suitable for high power. That should answer the question now. Okay, what are we doing? When I close in the switch, the energy is being stored in the primary inductance L1. Okay, so current is, the peak value of the current is given by VDC divided by L1 into D into T, provided it is operating in discontinuous mode. Current is starting from 0, increases linearly, attains the peak value of IP is given by this. Okay, this is the peak value. What is the total power of this converter? In the sense, the P in given by VDC is the input voltage. I am assuming it to be constant. Average of this, because from DT to T current is 0, source does not supply any power from DT to T. So average of this is, area of this triangle is half IP into VT by T. So power in, input power is given by the input voltage VDC into the average value of this current. So that also should be equal to power out, neglecting the losses. So neglecting the losses, this is the expression for IP. D is limited to 0.5. Now you see what will happen to IP as the power rating increases. So as IP increases, primary inductance for a given value of D will decrease. So your overall size of the transformer or the converter size may increase because of the peak currents. One of the advantages is output voltage can be significantly different. Other is isolation. Third is I can have multiple outputs. Of course, when you are doing solar, this may not be very important. What I mean is I can have multiple inputs. I can have multiple inputs. Current enters the dot, current enters the dot. Okay. Current enters the dot, current enters the dot. So, one primary, large number of secondary of different voltage ratios. Of course, regulating these voltages may be difficult. Of course, but then there are solutions. So this will having N2, N3, N4. So I can have different voltages, large number of voltages. It may not be possible to have using the conventional buck boost or a boost converter. So there's another advantages of having using a transformer, but then with large number of multiple windings. Yeah, one way to see here. I said the transformer may get saturated. How do I take care of this saturation? I can take care of saturation by providing a small air gap, because if there is an air gap, it will be difficult to saturate. But then the moment I use an air gap, there is going to be a leakage. Coils are not tightly coupled. Okay. Now, if there is a leakage, what will happen when I open the switch? See here. So if there is a leakage and the transformer equivalent circuit now becomes something like this, I am neglecting the winding resistance. this is V naught, this is diode, this is LM, this is LSL. Okay. When I close the switch, this is the way of the direction of current. Okay. And when I open the switch, switch could be anywhere. I will open the switch, whatever the current that was flowing through LM will flow through diode and V naught. What will happen to the energy associated with this inductor? Okay. There are solutions, of course. Okay. We have to handle, now we have to try to address, or we have to address the energy associated with this inductor. My circuit overall complexity increases. So here is one such solution. So you close S. This is how the circuit current will flow. Open S. Open S. Inductor current was flowing through this, that leakage inductor. This direction of current should remain the same for the leakage inductor. And it has to flow back to the source. So what I will do? I will modify the circuit something like this. Close the switch. This is how it will flow. Magnetizing current increases. Open S. Now this diode leakage battery. So that is the reason, see, in order to take care of saturation, I provide an air gap. If there is a provide an air gap, leakage flux will come. If there is a leakage flux, my circuit complexity will increase. Yeah, that is what you try to address one problem, it will give rise to another problem, but then solution do exist. So these are the various possible configuration. Only the you need to take care of the diode connections. You should not allow the both the coils to carry current. There in the flyback converter is the time. Now I will take few questions. Please come in chat mode. So there is a question. Sir, we know that example voltage source is a battery. Please tell me practically a current source. Yeah, current source, if I do not. How do I construct a current source? See, something like this. By regulating this voltage, say I have a fixed voltage VDC, this is L. Okay. By regulating this voltage, can't I make current flowing through the inductor approximately constant? Something like this. See, if V2 is less than VDC, current increases. So slowly current increases. Okay. If V2 is greater than VDC, current decreases. Okay. I'll redraw here. I'll repeat. If V2 is less than VDC, current flowing through the inductor increases. I assume that some steady state has reached. Current increases. Okay. The moment it touches an upper limit, I will try to reduce this, I will try to increase this voltage. So if this voltage is higher than VDC, voltage across the inductor is now negative, current will fall. Okay. When it touches a lower limit, I will again decrease this voltage V2. VDC I am not going to do anything. The next question is, can we have flyback converter having multiple output from different DC sources?
So it should be multiple input. Can we have flyback converters having multiple input from different DC sources? It should not be multiple output. I have type.
You mean to say that you have multiple inputs
from different energy sources for flyback converter?
No. See, what you do is, you have n number of sources coming. N number of sources coming to one common DC link. Are you with me? And a flyback. You can have n number of sources coming, solar 1, solar 2, solar 3, maybe have a small windmill, rectify it, whatever, and you can have this. But then remember, this is suitable for low power, not more than say 100 to 150 watts. In principle, yes, you can have one common DC link, connect all the sources there, okay. Why is not? It is possible. If this is what you have in mind.
But can we have flyback converters having multiple inputs?
See, let me not, can you draw the figure what you have in mind, scan it and send, then maybe tomorrow I will try to answer. Multiple inputs, flyback input, I do not know, see this is what you mean. These are the various inputs and maybe I have a selector switch connecting to various this one. Multiple inputs means what? In the sense I have finally I have to connect this transformer to, I have to connect a transformer to a source.
In the transformer there will be multiple primary coils.
Oh, multiple primary coils. Let me not answer straight away. In the sense, now this question is multiple primary coils. Oh. And one core, one transformer, let me not answer this, I have to study, I have to see what will happen to the flux in the core, because you are trying to energize the switches, they may not be, there is no, are they synchronized, all the switches? So, what I am saying is, if you are saying maybe, then I think I need to see what exactly is happening in the flux in the core. Let me not answer. Let me think. The question is how to find D max so that converter will not, it's not the question of converter saturating, it's the transformer saturating. The question is how to find D max so that converter will not saturate. Converter doesn't saturate, is the transformer saturating? Because you are the one who are designing the transformer, you are the one who are designing that inductor. You should ensure that, after all, it is BH loop will tell you whether it is saturates or not. Your NI per turn should not increase beyond the saturation. This is H, this is B. H is proportional to current that is flowing when you close the switch. So you should ensure that you should not go to the saturation level. Oh, the question is if VDC is varying continuously, how can we regulate V naught? See, fine, it's a good question. VDC is varying continuously. What are the minimum and maximum limits of VDC variation? And D is generally at 0.5. So you choose for a minimum condition, so for minimum input, D is 0.5. Okay. Now choose N2 by N1 accordingly. Okay. Now as VDC increases, V naught is the same, now D has to come down. It is okay, transformer may not get saturated. You follow what I am saying? VDC, now you can't be just saying that VDC is varying continuously. Fine, what are the upper VU and VL? So for VL, you know what is V naught, okay? You know the transfer function. For this you calculate D is equal to 0.5. So therefore, as V increases, same V naught, D has to come down. Choose N2 by N1 for VL and 0.5. As V increases above VL, D has to come down. Fair, fine. You are not increasing D above 0.5. So the apprehension of transformer getting saturated is not there. What is the maximum reverse blocking voltage rating? There is DC voltage here, it has to block DC. It is, please write under what is the reverse blocking, question is wrong. In the sense there is no reverse voltage being applied across the switch here. That can happen only in AC. And if I am using an AC, then I need to choose the devices accordingly. Conventional BJT, MOS, IGBT, they will not block the reverse voltages. So, as I understand correctly, looks like your question is what is the voltage rating of the switch? See, when the switch is open, when the switch is open, what is the voltage it has to withstand? This is VDC plus the voltage induced here. That is V naught into the turns ratio. Now, turns ratio takes suitable definition. V naught is being applied to N2. What is the voltage induced in N1? This is with, so this is positive or equivalent circuit VDC. Assume the dot is here, dots are negative, both the dots. And this is the switch S, this is the ground. There is no reverse voltage being applied across S. So voltage rating is VDC plus the induced voltage in the primary winding, that is V naught into turns ratio. Turns ratio, now you choose your, be careful while substituting the value of N. It is V naught is being applied to the secondary having N2 turns. What is the voltage being induced in the primary, you need to find out, and that is N here. The next question is, why can't we use boost converter alone to step up the voltage from 24 to 230? You want to use only boost converter, please go ahead and do. My best wishes to you. The next question, why flyback converter is not popular for power rating above 200? I showed you the transparency as well. See, this is the expression for P in is equal to P out. Now you have to do your paper and you have to take a paper and a pencil and design, and you have to find out what will happen to the transformer. As the power rating increases, what will happen to IP, the peak currents, the size. So I encourage you to do a simple transformer design problem. Say for example, 300 watt transformer, only one winding carrying current at a time. Okay, fix some input, D is 0.5, calculate IP, calculate L1, and try to get this L1. What will happen to the size and the peak current? Sir, can we know the power rating of buck boost and buck boost converters for design applications? See, we discussed about these converters. I told you we have a problem when, if there is a large ratios of input and output. That's all. Power rating we have not discussed. We can, power rating is not a problem. Only is the voltage ratings. If the output voltage ratio of V naught by VDC is very high, then I may not be able to use the conventional boost or buck boost. Okay, it is a problem with the voltage ratios. Chalo, bye.